receive the Right Worshipful Lord Mayor of Liverpool, Councillor Malcolm Kennedy.
That's much better. The idea is, though, Jane, that when we all sit down, we actually stay in your place.
Received from Councillors Christine Banks, Michelle Corrigan, Nick Cross, Cheryl Didsbury, John McIntosh, James Notes, Frank Pendergrast, Wendy Simon, Sue Walker and Joelle Calvert. Are there any further apologies to report? I'd like to emphasise that these are key meetings and I therefore request that everyone present, including the public, treat these meetings accordingly, which will enable the business to be dealt with effectively. The use of social media and filming for reporting proceedings is permitted during council meetings. This does not extend to the filming of members of the public, and anyone wishing to film the proceedings are also particularly directed to the very sensitive issue of filming children without the express permission of their parents.
Declaration of interests.
Can I remind members that you are only required to declare at meetings any disclosable pecuniary or prejudicial interests, in which case the member will need to leave the chamber during the consideration of the item. Are there any such declarations?
Okay. We now move on to the next item of the agenda, the special meeting, the Freedom Rural Association. Mayor Anderson.
Well, Mayor, can I move that the Freedom Rural Association, can I recommend that the Freedom Panel met has recommended the following organisations in recognition of their contribution to the City of Liverpool and its and the residents that live in the city, be included and inscribed on the City Council's Freedom Rural Association be approved. BBC, Radio Merseyside and Radio City.
Councillor Burr.
Can I second that, Lord
Mayor? Councillor Kemp. I had personal support on it.
Anybody else? Right, can we take a vote on that, please? Those in favour?
Three.
Those against? That's unanimous. Thank you very much indeed. Move on to item three, Citizen of Honour. Again, Mayor Anderson.
Hello, can I move the recommendation of the Freedom Panel that the following citizens be awarded the title of Citizen of Honour. Billy Butler, presenter of Radio Merseyside. Roger Phillips, presenter of Radio Merseyside. Linda McDermott, presenter of Radio Merseyside. Peter Price, presenter of Radio City.
Councillor
Also, Eric Lynch, who's a Liverpool active trade unionist and slave trade in Liverpool historian. Sir Peter Blake, an English pop artist best known for co-creating the sleeve design for the Beatles' Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Heart Club Band sleeve.
Councillor Bell, are you seconding?
I second that.
Right, can we take a vote? Those in favour? Those against? Unanimous. Thank you very much indeed. We'll move straight on to the items of business of the main meeting. Becky?
Can I advise members that apologies for absence have been received from Councillors Christine Banks, Michelle Corrigan, Nick Cross, Cheryl Didsbury, John McIntosh, James Noakes, Frank Pendergrast, Wendy Simon, Sue Walker and Joanne Calvert. Are there any further apologies?
Okay. May I advise members, this is some two pieces of absolutely excellent news. So to advise members of the recent birth of Councillor Cheryl Disney's daughter, and extends congratulations on behalf of the council to both Cheryl and Liam. And the second item, of course, is the recent birth of Councillor Michelle Corrigan's daughter. And we extend congratulations on behalf of the council to both Michelle and you. Cue round of applause. Declarations of interest, Becky?
Can I remind members that you are only required to declare at meetings any disclosable, pecuniary or prejudicial interests, in which case the members will need to leave the chamber during the consideration of the item. Are there any such declarations?
Right, next item, minutes of the last meeting. Are the minutes of the City Council meeting held on the 20th of September 2017 agreed? Right, we now come to public question time, petitions and statements. I have to advise you that three statements have been received. The first statement received from Dave Prentice in relation to item 9 on the agenda. And I'd like to invite Dave to come forward to address the council.
Good evening, everybody. Dave Prentice is General Secretary of Unison. It's a union of 1.3 million members, over a million of them within, providing our public services. And I'd like to thank you for the kind welcome this evening to actually speak to you about something that public service workers across the country and here in Liverpool have been going through for many years. 7 years of austerity. Pay increase is restricted to 1%, and inflation has been going for many years between 2 and 3%. We know on average that public service workers, local government workers especially, which has perhaps become the Cinderella service as we move forward, have probably incurred losses, probably on average about £3,000, even more, each year. And I'm here to talk to you this evening about the need to get rid of the pay cap, which this Tory government has laid on for the last 7 years. It's not working, it's not leading to growth in our country, hasn't dealt with the debt, and yet we found over 600,000 jobs have gone in public services, and those who remain, their pay is probably about £3,000 a year worse off than they were in 2009. And we can continue down this disastrous road. But Liverpool itself, and I've got many connections with Liverpool. I remember being in this chamber 35 years ago at least. I was an arbitrator on the school secretaries dispute, major dispute in the city. I've got family who live in Liverpool, and Liverpool to me, and I was also here in the days 32 years ago when Liverpool teetered on the brink, and in discussions with the leadership of the council then. So my roots go way, way back with Liverpool City Council. And for Liverpool itself, it's always been a place that's full of fairness. It's always believed that there's far more to society than Thatcherism. It's always believed that we should be taking care of people, that we believe in community. It's always been the bedrock of the people of Liverpool and the councillors who represent them. And I'm here today to say we need your help. And public service workers need your help. And your local government employees need your help to stand up for them. And I'm not personally bounce the table and say, you know, do an illegal budget and that'll be fine. We're not talking about terrorism. We're talking about real help. You need the funding. You need the funding so that you can pay your workforce fairly. You need the funding so you can pay your workforce in terms of equality and making sure that they've got high morale and they stay with the council. You need that funding. And part of our campaign is to talk to Labour councils especially, but all councils, but to talk to councils about that we're in this together on this occasion. Because you want to look after your workforce and we want to campaign with you to get the money that you need to provide the services, and instead of being the Cinderella service, which I just mentioned before. And it's not a cry, it's not a sob story. You know, but we do have people who work for Liverpool Council and for every council in this country on their way home from work face food banks. We've got people who just pay so low and they've got so much debt that they're scared stiff of the festive season coming. And we can name names, and it's not just about a certain category. It's everybody, so whether it's the gardeners, whether it's the cleaners, whether it's the I'll keep away from schools at the moment, but whether it's someone's directly employed by Liverpool City Council in the mainstream. And it affects the schools as well, with teaching assistants, teaching staff. They themselves worried about how they look after their children. Many of them have had pay frozen for many years, and many jobs have gone in that time. And we're here to talk to you, or I'm here as General Secretary of Unison, to say that we can work together to get round what has become, I think, a real sore on our society, that we can treat people so badly. And you've got to say, this society, our economy, was not smashed by the people who provide public services. It was smashed by the rich and powerful in our society, mainly in London, being greedy, being over-greedy, testing things that they should not have done. And yet we pay the price for that happening. And I do worry with Brexit that again it will be public services. If it goes wrong, we'll pay the price. And what we've got to think in terms of is how we can make a stand, not just a symbolic motion, but how we can commit ourselves to actually addressing the problems that are now arising, how we can get a decent pay increase for local government workers, and how we can get the funding to actually give that decent pay increase. So I'd like to thank you for inviting me this evening. I'm not making a table thumping speech. This is a genuine approach to you, for your help, and to recognise the problems that you're going through, and say together, we cannot allow this Tory government to continue down this road. They're now talking about another 5 years of austerity, and its local government has paid the price each time. A third of income gone in many areas, more in some areas. And we've got to say, enough is enough. The time is now right to mount a political campaign to get the austerity agenda moved to an agenda for growth. Now is the time to get the cap lifted It's a bit more than that. It's getting the cap lifted so that we can afford to pay decent pay increases to the people who provide our services, public services, in Liverpool itself. And my worry, more than anything, is that this government, they will pick and choose. They will cherry pick. The nurses are our members, we're the biggest nursing union, but the increases can't be just about nurses. It can't be just about teachers. It cannot be just about people in uniforms. It's got to be uniform increases for all workers who provide our public services. And some of the lowest paid have borne the biggest burden. So our campaign isn't just on Belfast sections. It's saying if there is to be movement, it's got to be for all public service workers. Public service workers deserve that rise. But we accept the difficulties of the lack of funding, and we will work with you, we will campaign with you, a massive political campaign in order to get the funding that's required. And we've been doing some novel things for trade union. Some of you may have seen the short video that we've just done on the patterns of that. And now people patting public service workers on the back, and then those people say, we need some money to live. We don't just need a pat on the back. And that video was shown, there were 1.4 million hits in 48 hours in the video that we did, that we released 2 or 3 days ago. This campaign is taking off. We've got a campaign in Parliament, a debate in Parliament on the 4th of December. Over 100,000 people signed the signatures saying we've got to debate public service pay. And we'd like you to be behind us as we enter that debate in the Great Hall in Parliament. And we will continue taking the political action in order to get that support from politicians and people like yourself for something that is long overdue, a decent pay rise for your workers, for your employees, and for our members in Liverpool. So thank you for inviting me tonight, and I do really look forward to the debate itself.
Important for Dave, for me, and for other people up and down the country to make
is that you will not divide and split us by giving one section a lift, by lifting the pay cap against the others. It has to be for everybody, as everybody is suffering under this administration. And we give our total commitments. And I'd just like, finally, Dave, to say that, you know, we are certainly in this chamber all committed to support the trade unions. We've done that and shown that in many, many ways. When we've had to force to be making cuts in services, we've made sure that JTUC working alongside us has made sure that people have left this administration with dignity and with respect, that paying the higher rates of voluntary severance in order for them to go with dignity and respect. At least the most dignified thing we can do is to support our comrades as they leave this authority because of the cuts imposed on us. We'll continue to do that, we'll continue to work with JTUC, and we'll continue to fight for a better deal for all the workers that work for this council.
We have a second statement received from Ian Fletcher in relation to item 9 on the agenda, and I'd like to invite Ian to come forward to address the council.
Well, members of the council, thanks very much for inviting us today. My name is Ian Fletcher from the Royal College of Nursing and the Merseyside Regional Officer. The officer is very pleased to support this motion. 7 years of global inflation pay awards has seen nursing salaries fall far behind the cost of living over the last 7 years, down by 14%. We're seeing experienced staff leave the profession, and those who stay are overstretched and undervalued and under-resourced. This summer, I've seen members of UNSIL this successfully campaign to scrap the 1% pay cap on pay increases. But we don't know what this will mean in practice. We have suspicions that we wait to see what the Chancellor has to say in a couple of weeks. But whatever the award is, will be a long way to go to close the gap created by year on year of real term pay cuts to nurses and other public sector workers. So we're calling on the government to show they value nursing staff by putting the payable in line with RPI, plus an £800 one-off payment to try to begin to make up for years of lost earnings before RPI. Research by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation shows that 41% of nurses, more than 4 in 10, earn less than the minimum income standard, and this is a 50% increase from 7 years ago, so real change there. These years of underinvestment in staff has left the NHS struggling to maintain high standards for patients, and that's what public sector workers and NHS workers are there for, to provide services. There are 40,000 unfilled nurse jobs in Britain, 4,000 in the northwest, and hundreds in Liverpool alone. For the first time, the NMC, the Nursing and Midwifery Council that regulates nurses, has reported that over the last 12 months, more nurses left the register than joined. This is a net loss. Pay is undoubtedly a factor in this sense. And this, of course, has been made worse by Brexit, the looming disaster that we're all looking at. There's a dramatic number in the drop of EU nurses coming to work in this country. Last year, 10,000 EU nurses registered in this country to come and work here. This year, so far, just 1,000. Again, this is the NHS can't sustain and continue to deliver the high quality services that we all want. So a meaningful, and I mean meaningful, cash injection to the Chancellor will start to begin to make the NHS a safer place, not least by stopping this hemorrhage of skilled, essential, and expensively trained staff. We're asking you to support this motion, not just on behalf of nurses, but we're talking solidarity with all public sector workers, and I echo his friends' words on that, but to send a message on behalf of all public sector workers facing these hardships, food banks, second jobs, underpaid and value. So we're calling upon the government to put its money where its mouth is when they talk about fair and equal society by committing the funding to give nurses and other public sector workers an above inflation pay award. Anything less amounts to yet another pay cut and a continuing risk to services and patients. And Finally, we call upon the government to fully fund any award that they might make, rather than the burden again falling upon already struggling NHS employees and other public sector employees. So again, thanks for inviting us today. I hope you'll support this motion, and I'm sure you will. Thanks very much.
She gives us the mum's stare if we do shout, it's chilling. Helping us understand what's going on, attending meetings in schools over our children, supporting some of us through the child protection process with their own babies and children, but basically mapping the service out for us that are available in the city for young people to access. We do believe all children and young people should have that someone who can put their coat on and say, come on, let's sort this out. By this I mean empowering parents, schools, council officers, the community altogether. If we get this right, I'm sure children and young people will feel respected and cherished enough to give the respect and courtesy back to our elders. By furthermore, we will hopefully have a culture change leading to a very child-friendly and safe, inclusive city. The Children and Care Council are going to be supporting the Leaving Care Manager with the local offer for care leavers. Our input is going to be crucial to getting this offer right for care leavers. I would really like to thank Barry Kushner and our new Director, Steve Reddy, for getting the ball rolling on making Liverpool a better and safe place to live and grow up in. The Children and Care Council are also going to be involved with the process of getting this right for Liverpool kids. Because we may have started our journey as kids in care and then care leavers, but we want to move on, have our own families and make our kids' futures safe for them to grow up, knowing they will always have the Liverpool community watching their backs and protecting them. Parks for them to play in and knowledge they are equal to us, all not matter of culture or race. They are equal and treated fairly. Thank you for taking the time to listen to me, and I'm sorry, Mayor Jo, but if they get this right, you will have to build a lot more houses in Liverpool, because everyone will.
Said that she articulated the case of the reason why we need to do it.
And I think, you know, she mentioned Barry and Steve Rennie, our new director, who is committed to making this happen, along with everybody, I'm sure, in the chamber. So on behalf of us, Caitlin, thank you for what you do. And of course, we will try to do our utmost to make sure that we support you in every way we can. And by that, I mean all of the children in care, but to actually make our city that child friendly city that you wish us to have. Sure, we work really hard to achieve it.
Thank you, Mayor. The next item is urgently executive decisions taken last cycle, but it's not been submitted. We move straight on to item 5, Mayor of Liverpool announcements and updates. So, Mayor Anderson to present any such updates or announcements.
Well, maybe just a few announcements from me, just an update on where we currently are in respect of the Chief Executive. As I mentioned at the last council meeting, when something to report back in detail, I will do, but there is still the independent investigation ongoing. Opposition leaders have been offered the opportunity to meet to get an update legally from where we are. I think a number of them took up that particular option, so I'll keep you, as I said, informed when there is indeed something to inform you about. Mayor of the city, I'm really proud that we've led, despite those challenges that I just mentioned in regard to Dave Prentice's contribution about the financial challenges that we faced and the challenges that we faced in terms of number of officers that we lost. You know, we lost just under 3,000 officers in this council, and of course that's had a huge impact on what we do. But I still believe that we are a progressive council. We've not only delivered on innovative and creative things, but we've been open and transparent and willing to listen to constructive and critical comments made about the council. Recently, of course, the Hope and Glory Festival, when people were intent on making mischief blame the council, we called for an independent review, which looked at what went wrong and looked at what happened and reported back its conclusions totally independently. And came to its conclusions without any interference. And we've acted and will reflect on those comments that we were made in that report. And it wasn't a knee-jerk reaction, it was a considered and measured response call for the inquiry. So, as I said, that's the type of administration that we are. I'm absolutely proud, again, just to remind people of the challenges that we face as a city in terms of the reduction of officers. But I'm so proud of every one of our officers in this council and the progress that they make on behalf of the council in and on a daily basis. Progressive policies, progressive ideas, ones that we can be proud of. And as I said, we are not afraid of criticism, constructive or negative. We'll look at it, we'll listen to it, and we'll act. And so I've written today to the LGA asking them, at their convenience, to undertake a full peer review of our council. I'm asking them to look at the direction of travel. I'm asking them to look how we are transforming services and transforming ourselves as a council with the things that we intend to deliver on, not only in the near future, but in the distant future. So I want to make sure that the peer review assesses how we are as a council, what we're doing to give value to our residents, and that they want to look at us and to see whether we are providing value for money and efficient council services. So as I said, I've invited the LGA to come and have a look, full forensic review, a peer review, and our governance systems, our systems, our partnerships, and all of the things and all of those that we engage in, to look at our finances, our investments, our relationships that we have with our stakeholders, and ultimately the quality of services that we provide to our residents in difficult financial times. As I said, we're happy to listen to them and listen to any recommendations that they might wish to confirm to us. But as I said, I believe that we have the best staff members in all the government here in Liverpool. And as I said, we welcome the peer review. We've had, of course, peer reviews across the organisation in different parts of the organisation. And as I said, just to confirm that I've written to them today to ask them to do a peer review, undertake a peer review at their convenience, and I'll keep the council updated as to when that happens. Next year, we've been talking about our plans for 2018 and for our cultural programme for next year. It's 10 years, of course, since we were awarded the accolade of European Capital of Culture. And we're not sitting back and looking at that as something that we achieved and forgotten. Since we became the administration in 2010, we've actually provided, in fact, indeed, we are looked on as an exemplar in providing culture and events up and down the country and use it as an economic driver to create jobs and opportunities within the city. But our 18 for 18 programme, we called it 18 for 18, but in actual fact, the events and the things that we're doing is probably more like 40 for 18. There's going to be that many things happening and some really exciting things that we will announce over the next couple of days in actual fact that will make people proud of what we're doing and what we're achieving. And the reports that we've had from our partners in the private sector who are sponsoring us, the universities and others who are joining with us have been absolutely, in fact, overwhelmingly positive. So look forward to announcing some more things over the next few days. When Caitlin was talking about providing houses, very shortly we'll be talking about a report that goes to Cabinet, which will be setting up our own housing company. With the plan to actually build 10,000 houses over the next 8 to 10 years, there will be a mixture of homes to rent and rent to buy, to lease social housing, bringing back some more derelict properties, and it will be looking at providing accommodation for foster carers, bigger properties. As you know, people within the city predominantly live in terrace properties, so we'll be looking at building houses for people to actually rent or for us to provide and they look after young people in care, but also be providing accommodation for people to move out of, elderly people to move out of their own homes that they own or whether they rent them into more bungalows as we support people who have become disabled, people who have become inactive or have health problems rather than spending money on adaptations. We'll actually be providing the right sort of accommodation that we have. In all the years that I've been involved in local government, I think our housing company is probably the most exciting, innovative thing that this council will have ever done. And I look forward to holding a seminar with councillors to give you more details and more information as we go on. The hopes for a pound, of course, have been a huge success, and we've been up around Webster Triangle the other day, where we gave a property to a young couple, a middle-aged couple called Rachel and Sammy, and the two daughters. And what a wonderful family, what a beautiful family, and a wonderful reception that we got. It shows what people can do if they use their imagination, a bit of their funding to actually get onto property ladder. That's the, we've got 120 of these. We've already got in tranche two now, about 250. We've got 2,500 people that have applied to be on the scheme. There's only one component of how we are delivering housing. You'll have read yesterday that
that we are thanks here, that we announced yesterday our deal with LMH about building affordable rent to buy houses on Ed's Lane. So, Caitlin, you know, we are listening, we are active, and we are going to respond, not only because housing is a social requirement, but it also makes huge economic sense. And that's why, you know, I take great pride in what we've done around Anfield with the Deputy Mayor's drive, the commitment to Anfield Village, and also to members and councillors in, for instance, Norris Green. We no longer call it the Boot Estate, which we inherited from Mr. Kent, but we actually have now turned that into a vibrant, beautiful place in which to live, which is a proud part of Liverpool and indeed the Liverpool City region. So we will come back to you probably after we have announced the Cabinet report, which I think goes in about 3 weeks' time. The report goes, I will go online next day. So we'll have a seminar which we will engage with you and show you where we are developing our houses and what types of houses we will be building. That's it. Lord Mayor, I end my announcements with that positive news about houses in the City of Liverpool.
I'm going to call Councillor Kemp. Can I just remind people that to stick to questions if we can rather than long political statements? That was not particularly aimed at you, Councillor Kemp, but just generally. Okay?
I shall have a long cough and a very long question. I shall be brief.
I shall be brief, my Lord Mayor. First of all, I welcome the fact that after 5 years the Mayor is going to have a corporate peer review of the city, because I have been asking him to do it for that long. But I wonder if he could tell us if the work currently done by the former Chief Executive of Bradford Council, Tony Reeves, within this council looking at the organisation, will feed into that peer review. And perhaps he could tell us more about the purpose of the reorganisation review being done by Mr. Reeves. The second thing is a little confusion perhaps about his Homes statement today, because I heard the other mayor, Mayor Rotherham, make a statement about housing numbers yesterday. Are they the same numbers that Mayor Rotherham wants? Are they different numbers? Are they going to be delivered in a different way? And if the mayor is now going to provide the housing that we need, which will presumably, in some cases, be on land that we own, will he think it right that we should abandon the Red Road partnership, which is building homes that aren't required, in the same way that he has just described about being affordable homes for the people of Liverpool? And secondly, could I just congratulate him for his second U-turn of changing his mind on the World Heritage Site? We love to see a repentant sinner coming into the front.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Addison, that's a Mayor Addison, sorry.
Lord Mayor, can I thank Councillor Richard Tuesday Kemp for his wonderful questions? He's called Tuesdays because when his dad looked at him, he looked at his mother and said, we'll have to call him a day. The fact that let's deal with them in reverse order. I've made no U-turn on World Heritage. I've consistently